Bhishma's one question to Krishna. Bhishma, the terrible, also known as Pitamaha, Gangaputra, and Devavrata, was a statesman of Kuru kingdom and one of the most powerful warriors in the epic Mahabharata. He was the eighth and only surviving son of the Kuru king Shantanu and the river goddess Ganga. He was related to both the Pandavas and the Kauravas through his half-brother Vichitravirya. So who were the Kauravas and the Pandavas? They were two collateral branches of the family that participated in the epic struggle of the Mahabharata. Although the Kaurava is the senior branch of the family, Duryodhana, the eldest Kaurava, is younger than Yudhishthira, the eldest Pandava. Duryodhana and Yudhishthira claim to be the first in line to inherit the throne. The struggle culminates in the great epic battle of Kurukshetra, in which the Pandavas are ultimately victorious. The battle produces complex conflicts in kinship and friendship, instances of family loyalty and duty taking precedence over what is right, as well as the converse. So coming back to Bhishma, originally he was named Devavrata. He was made the heir apparent of the kingdom. However, he ceded his rights for his father's happiness and took the vow of lifelong celibacy. Because of this terrible oath, he came to be known as Bhishma and was blessed to live as long as he wanted. He played a major role in the political affairs of the Kuru kingdom and participated in the Kurukshetra war from the side of the Kauravas. On the 11th day of the war, the Pandava prince Arjuna, with the help of Shikhandi, pierced Bhishma with numerous arrows and paralyzed him on the bed of arrows. After spending 51 nights on the arrow bed, Bhishma left his body on the Uttarayana, the winter solstice. Before his death, he handed over the Vishnu Sahasranama to the Emperor Yudhishthira. Before we talk about how the story starts, it doesn't matter if he fell on the bed of arrows or not. The question is important, that what question did he ask Krishna? As Krishna knows what is on Bhishma's mind and Bhishma had the curiosity, so Bhishma, in his withering pain, steadily caught hold of Krishna's hand and asked him to please answer his one question. What kind of sin would he had to commit to have fought against God? I am the biggest constant critic of Duryodhana, for whom my mind has an utter dislike for. And how could I have fought side by side with him, and that too against you? What kind of sin would I have had to commit? I don't understand the sin that I have committed, standing against you and shooting arrows at you. Hell is better than this. So Sri Krishna showed him his past four lives. Then one of the lives of those four lives goes like this. Sri Krishna said, I will show you how you are responsible. In one of Bhishma's prior lives, his guru was a very elevated yogi. Mostly he had merged with God consciousness, and God loved his guru a lot because he was very selfless, desireless guru on the way to liberation, and Bhishma was his special pupil. Due to this, Bhishma got proud, and as he was special and also bright and sharp-witted, his ego was elevated. This fact was not kept from the guru, and the guru was easily able to understand this aspect of him. Bhishma was a scholar and he was very intelligent. He was able to grasp all knowledge in the matter of minutes, and this caused him to get proud. Then he started thinking he is the best that's around here. Then he started to have ill feelings about his guru and he started to dislike him. He was not totally surrendered to his guru, and that's important to note. So the guru one day asked him not to take the evening lectures as a test to Bhishma, and Bhishma was insulted as he was chosen one and he felt he should always take the evening lectures. He used to take the lectures of the pupils and he was furious at his guru, and the guru was unhinged. He asked another pupil to take the lecture for that day and Bhishma was even more furious. Who is this person and does he even have the qualification to take up the lectures? He is no one compared to me, said Bhishma. And in the afternoon, he used to sit beside his guru for lunch. And on that day, the guru asked him not to have lunch. Bhishma was then raging and he reached his boiling point. The guru repeated, "No lunch for you." As he sat outside the lunch hall, he was fuming, and when the guru came out, he shouted at his guru, "Why are you punishing me like this? What kind of lesson are you trying to teach me? I am the most capable pupil here." He asked, "Why are you behaving like this with me?" His guru just smiled at Bhishma and he said, after washing his hands, "The question is, just ask yourself, don't ask me." And then he didn't talk to him and Bhishma was even more angry. The next day went in a similar way too. He was asked not to sit between the saints and that made him even more unsettled. He said, "You are now insulting me in front of everyone. Are the people that you selected capable enough? I am the scholar that's been around here and I am well accomplished and you know that. The person that you loved, why are you showing me this now?" Bhishma thought that the guru was responsible for this happening. The guru told him, "Don't show me your face until you have changed the state of your affairs." Bhishma said to his guru, "Henceforth, I am going to torment you and you better watch out. You are talking with me with a high ego and you have a feeling of pride. I don't respect that anymore." So, an important point to note here is that the guru's only wish is to advance his disciples, and his ways and means could be very unorthodox. On the way to advancement, when the disciple starts to plummet and tries to resist in his pathways to liberation, the disciple comes under the wrong assumption that the guru is in fact wrong and he thinks that the guru has faltered. So continuing on, Bhishma said to his guru, "You have started to have an ego now. You have changed. I don't like your behavior." And in spite of the anger, he left his guru and left the monastery. He started then with a hard penance. The penance that he did was profound. The reason being that he was resolute in his determination and he did a very long penance. And the important point was that in his penance, he was furious as his mind couldn't let go of what had happened to him earlier. Generally, when you sit in a penance, your mind is supposed to get quieter. But his mind was rattled and uneasy. His penance was great, but the shocking part was that he never forgot his rage for his guru. Years passed by, and after a lot of years, he had a rendezvous with God, and God asked him, "What blessing should I bestow upon you? You have made me very happy, as you have done a pleasing penance, and I am pleased." Bhishma said in response, "I would like to ask you to bring about the execution of my guru." God said that you think this is a blessing, but it's in fact a curse. This is a castigation. Are you going to ask to execute God? What kind of penance is this? He said, "I don't know anything. I just want my will to be done. I want to bring about the destruction of my guru." And then God told him, "Even though you ask for this, I would like to tell you that God is indestructible, indivisible, self-existing and self-manifesting, and the destruction of such an entity is only wishful thinking. So in response to your request, I deny it and curse you instead that you will have to fight the battle against such a God one day." Since he was a Brahmin in that life, He didn't understand the depth of what God had communicated. It was way beyond his intellect to comprehend. As Brahmins, only involved in study of the scriptures and never fight or wage wars against any class of people. So finally, the outcome of the cursed life led him into the war where he had to stand against Krishna. And Krishna showed it all to him and he could see it right in the moment with his eyes closed, and it played like a movie. And as the movie ended, tears streamed down his face and he asked Krishna, "Why did I behave like this?" Now you need to listen carefully as to what Krishna mentioned, and it's worth a thousand words. Krishna said that the ego is the man's biggest adversary because it sneaks up in his mind and like a burglar, and the man takes refuge in it and finds comfort in it. If you ever say to a person that he is egoistic, he will resist it even more. As we cannot see it, and the bigger it gets, the more blindsided you get to the fact that it's right there, right in front of you, but you refuse to recognize it. Once the ego rises to the next level, the jiva just merges with it. "Your foe has always been your ego," said Krishna. "You have been punished for the chaos you have created in your past life, due to which you had to fight against the people you loved, the Pandavas and myself included. As Arjun was my mirror image, so your futile life has been a product of your ego, and you have fulfilled the prophecy of that life, and the karma is now settled. The vows that you have been committing were all acts of your ego. Your vows have chastised you literally, because you took oath after oath and you didn't stop. You didn't stop at one, but you kept on going. And this pledge is another form of ego only. Never keep oaths like this, as it takes away you from spirituality, and then you are unable to focus, and the spirituality will begin where the ego ends. Hence, a fall from grace of Bhishma is due to the pride that he had about himself. And once the focus goes on the ego, it leads to destruction. So he might not have been wrong when he berated his fellow disciples in the past life, but the fall from grace happened when he asked for the destruction of God. God is our creator. Is it possible to ever win against your creator? In the same way, all that fought Krishna were history.
How did you like the content on Bhishma's one question to Krishna? Please let me know in the comment section below. If you like the content, please share and subscribe to the channel so that I can continue making more videos like this. Thanks again, and I'll see you in the next video.